Welcome for today's discussion. Today we are going to discuss about intestinal nematodes. This is in continuation with the earlier class that you all had on intestinal nematodes. So today we will be learning intestinal nematodes too. The objectives of today's class is to know the general properties of the nematodes, classify the nematodes based on habitat, and to understand the life cycle pathogenicity, lab diagnosis and prevention and treatment of the enlisted nematodes. To have a small introduction about the nematodes, nematodes belong to family Nematoda. These nematodes, they live in the intestinal tract or in tissues of humans. Now, the name nematodes is derived from the word, or it means actually thread-like. Okay, these nematodes can be found as free living forms in the soil and water also, and there are many species of nematodes. So about 5 lakh species of nematodes can be found. These nematodes have non-segmented and cylindrical body. The ends are tapering. These possess a shiny, tough, hyaline, acellular cuticle or the skin, which may be smooth, spined or rigid. The nematodes have their own digestive system, which is complete. They possess mouth, esophagus, intestine and anus. These nematodes also have a simple excretory and nervous system. The male and the female reproductive organs are present. The sexes are separate in the nematodes. Male is smaller than the female and is posteriorly curved. The females are either viviparous, that is they produce larvae, or they are oviparous, that is they produce or lay eggs, or they are ovoviviparous, that is eggs are laid which hatch out immediately. Coming to the classification of nematodes. So nematodes can be classified based on the habitat of the adult worms. So we have the nematodes which inhibit the small intestine, for example, Ascaris lumbricoides, Ankylostoma duodenale, Micator americanus, Strongyloides torporalis, Trichinella spiralis, and Capillaria filipinensis. Then we have those which are found in the cecum and the vermiform appendix, like Enterobius vermicularis and Trichuris trichura. Then we have those which are found in the subcutaneous tissues like Dracunculus medinensis, Onposacca volvulus, Loa loa, Mansonella quercens and Mansonella ozadi. Then we have those which are found in the lymphatic system like Vaucheraria bancrofti and Bergia malaya, found in the lungs like Strongyloides torporalis and found in the conjunctiva like Loa loa. Today we are going to learn about Trichinella spiralis, Capillaria filipinensis, Enterobius vermicularis and Trichuris trichura. So first let's see about Trichinella spiralis. So Trichinella spiralis causes a disease called as trichinosis. The clinical picture that is it causes is called as trichinosis. This worm is also called as the trichina worm. Most of the human cases of trichinosis are due to ingestion of infected pork. Then the habitat, the adult worms are found in the mucosa of the small intestine, in the duodenum or jejunum of man and animals like pigs, bears and rats. The incised larvae are present in the striated muscles of these hosts, and there are no pre-living stages. Coming to the adult worm of Trichinella spiralis, the male is 1.4 to 1.6 mm in length, the female is 3 to 4 mm in length. Okay, so this worm is the smallest nematode which infects man. The female is viviparous. The incised larvae in the striated muscles of beak is the infective form to humans. Ingestion of improperly cooked pork causes infection in humans. The worm is localized in the small intestine, and the commonly involved muscles are the muscles of the diaphragm, intercostal muscles, the deltoid muscles, the pectoralis major, and the biceps. Coming to the life cycle, it has a simple life cycle. Both adult and larval forms occur in the same host. Humans act as the accidental host. The infected form of Trichinella spiralis for humans are the incised larvae in the pork. And that of the animals is in ingestion of the incised larvae in other infected animals. So after ingestion of the improperly cooked meat of infected animal, the infection occurs. Okay. Then the cyst wall of the incised larvae is digested in the small intestine. So this larvae is released in the small intestine. So this liberated larvae then matures into the adult worms in the next 40 hours. The males and the females develop. The male fertilizes the females and then it dies. Then the gravid female burrows into the intestinal mucosa and then deposits larvae there. Subsequently, the larvae enters the bloodstream and gets distributed all over the body. They incise preferentially the striated muscles of the eye, tongue, and finally the heavy muscles of the upper and the lower extremities. The larvae may live in this incised form for the next few years, and then this is the dead end of the parasite in humans. And whereas in the wildlife, the cycle is maintained by ingesting the flesh of infected animal. One animal ingests the flesh of the other infected animal. So, to summarize the life cycle, we have incised larvae in the pig muscles, which is the infected form. Then infection is acquired by eating undercooked pork. The larvae is released in the small intestine and develops into the adult worm in the next 40 hours. The male dies after fertilizing the female. The female deposits larvae in the intestinal mucosa when it burrows into it. And then the larvae enters into the circulation. The larvae gets deposited and gets incised in the striated muscles, and then the cycle continues. In humans, it is a dead end. Coming to the pathogenicity, the disease which is caused as Trichinella snelliensis or trichinosis, and the clinical features depends on the stage. In the stage of intestinal invasion, abdominal pain may occur, nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea may be caused. Then in the stage of larval migration, fever, urticarial rash, splinter, hemorrhages, periorbital and facial edema can occur. And in the stage of incestation, there is asymptomatic infection it is asymptomatic in light infections, and in heavy infections, myalgia can occur. Then next, coming to the laboratory diagnosis. The muscle biopsy can be collected. So the specimens can be collected from the deltoid and the biceps. At least 1 gram of muscle should be taken for biopsy, and it should be preferably from near the tendon insertion. And then the muscles can be digested with trypsin and mounted on a glass slide and examined under the microscope. And we look for the young larvae, which may be present in the digested muscles. Then we can also tease the muscle tissues and on a slide, and then we can observe it under in a drop of saline. and these muscles can be teased or they can be squeezed between two slides, and these muscle tissues can be stained with safranin and then observed. So here we have a picture of such muscle tissue which is stained with safranin. Then we can have non-specific indications, like blood examination can be done to look for eosinophilia between the second and the fourth week. Then we can also go for serology to detect the specific antibodies. Then apart from this, we can also have a proper history of the patient to find out or look for the consumption of raw or inadequately cooked pork in the last few days. Then we can go for radiological examination, look for calcified cysts which on x-rays. Then we can also have a stool examination, which may sometimes demonstrate the adult worms and the larvae. Then next, coming to the treatment, we can use thiabendazole and nebendazole, which will act against the adult worms. And then for prevention, one should have properly cooked meat or properly cooked pork should be ingested, and feeding bits and refuse from slaughterhouses and farms to pigs should be avoided to break the life cycle. Next, coming to Enterobius vermicularis, this is also known as threadworm, pinworm or seedworm. It is distributed worldwide and is more prevalent in the temperate than in the tropical areas. And over 30 crore of people, especially children, suffer with its infection. Coming to the adult worms, the males are 2 to 5 mm in length and the females are about 8 to 13 mm. The females are oviparous. Eggs are present. The eggs are 60 microns in dimensions and these are non-bistained. And a very characteristic feature of the eggs is that it is plano-convex with a coiled embryo. Plano-convex is one side is flat. So here we have a picture of the egg. So here we have one side which is flat and the other one opposite to the flat side is a convex side. So that is the plano-convex presentation of the egg. And then inside it, there is a coiled embryo. This embryonated egg is the infective form to humans, and infection occurs by ingestion of this embryonated egg or by auto-infection. And the site of localization of the worm is the large intestine. Coming to the life cycle, it has a simple life cycle which requires only one host. So the life cycle is completed in humans. The infective form for humans is Enterobius vermicularis and the embryonated egg of the parasite. Then transmission occurs through fecal route. After ingestion of the infective form, the egg, these eggs hatch out in the intestine and release the larvae. This larvae develops in the large intestine now into a mature worm and it lives there, it stays there. It matures into an adult male and female worm. The adult fertilizes the female and then dies. This graver female then migrates out from the anus and lays a lot of immature eggs in the perianal skin. So the egg burden is heavy, about 10,000 immature eggs can be laid at a time. Eggs are generally laid at the night, in night. The larvae present in the eggs then develop within the next 6 hours. So once the egg is laid, it takes about 6 hours for the larvae to develop inside. Such immature eggs are the infective forms, and then these eggs can reinfect the same host to reach to other. Reinfection can be due to hand to mouth passage or by a process of retrograde infection. In retrograde infection, larvae hatches out on the perianal skin and then travels back through the anus to the cecum to develop them. The eggs laid on perianal skin contaminate the clothes and the beddings, the linen. And infection can be transmitted when handling such contaminated clothes or during bed making. This transmission due to contamination of hands can occur. So eggs become sometimes airborne also and can be inhaled. And these inhaled eggs, they stick to the pharyngeal mucosa and are swallowed. The life cycle of Enterobius vermicularis takes about 1 month to complete. So then coming to the clinical features. So due to migration of the worms, the presentations may be due to migration of the worms. So it may present in the perianal, perineal and the vaginal itching or pruritus, which is more severe at night times. And because of this itching, the patient suffers from insomnia and restlessness, and there is nocturnal enuresis also. Coming to the lab diagnosis and treatment, so the adult worms can be detected in the feces or in the perianal region. So we have a special technique of collection of NIH swabs. So these swabs are present on a shaft which is having a cellophane tape, okay, which is tied with a rubber. So we collect the swab from the perianal region with the help of this cellophane which is attached on the shaft, and then again put it back into the test tube. Here we have a picture of this NIH swab, and then transported to the lab. Then we remove this rubber band and stick the cellophane on a slide, and we can look for the eggs of the parasite. We can look for the non-bile stained eggs of the parasite. And then coming to the treatment, the mebendazole can be used. So here we have the egg, the picture of egg we have just seen in the earlier slide also. Next, coming to Trichuris tritura, also called as the whipworm. This is the third most commonest nematode after roundworm, that is Ascaris lumbricoides, and the hookworm to infect humans. About 50 crore people are infected worldwide. It is commonest in moist and warm areas like Southern and East Asia, Caribbean and the tropical African regions. It is also seen in India. Coming to the adult worms, the adult worms are about 30 to 50 mm in length. The eggs are present. The eggs are about 60 microns in dimensions. These are bile stained, and the eggs again have a very characteristic appearance. The eggs are barrel shaped. So here we have a picture of egg of Trichuris tritura. Excuse me. Then the eggs are barrel shaped with mucus plugs at both the poles. So these are the mucus plugs at both the poles, and the egg has an unsegmented ovum. The mature embryonated egg is infective form to humans, and infection occurs by ingestion. The worm can be found in the large intestine. Coming to the life cycle is simple and requires only one host, and humans, the life cycle is completed in humans. The eggs, which are the infective forms, which contain a fully developed infected larvae, are ingested along with food or water. The food or water is contaminated with these eggs, and humans ingest this egg. Eggs hatch out in the small intestine, the larvae are liberated, and larvae develops into adult worms. The adult worms migrate to the cecum and the appendix. There they mature into male and females. In the cecum and the appendix, the mature females lays characteristic eggs, and then these eggs are passed along with the feces. The eggs then subsequently mature into the soil and become infected to a new host. And so the life cycle will continue. Coming to the clinical feature, so Trichuris tritura causes trichuriasis. The symptoms depend on the worm burden. If there are less than 10 worms, the infection is asymptomatic. In heavier infection, there is chronic profuse mucus and bloody diarrhea with abdominal pain and edematous rectum. Then a person may also suffer from malnutrition, weight loss, and anemia. Coming to the lab diagnosis and treatment and prevention. So simply, the stool can be collected and a wet mount of it can be done on a slide, and we look for a bile stained egg with bipolar mucus. For treatment, albendazole and mebendazole can be used, and for prevention, there should be proper disposal of the night soil and consumption of uncooked vegetables and fruits should be avoided. So if one is preferring to have salads, these fruits and vegetables can be washed thoroughly and then consumed. Excuse me. Next, coming to Capillaria filipinensis, this nematode causes intestinal capillariasis. The female is 2.5 to 4.3 microns and it is longer than males. The males are 2.3 to 3.17 microns in length and they reside in the small intestine. Eggs are present. These eggs are peanut shaped. So these are almost like the eggs of Triturus tritura and they are surrounded by striated thick shell. Mucus plugs are present, but these plugs are less prominent and don't protrude out like those in the Triturus tritura. Coming to the life cycle, the life cycle is completed in two hosts. There is a definitive host and the intermediate host. The definitive host is fish eating birds, which are the natural definitive hosts for the parasites, and humans act as accidental definitive host. Then it has an intermediate host. So the intermediate host is the fresh and saltwater fish containing the larval stage. The mode of transmission of infection is humans acquire infection by ingestion of undercooked or pickled fishes which contain the infected larvae. So the larvae has to be present in the fish which is consumed by humans and humans get infected. Continuing with the life cycle, so humans acquire infection by ingestion of a fish containing the larvae. The larvae then reaches the small intestine and burrows into the mucosa of the jejunum. And then it develops into adults over there. The adult female then lays eggs. These eggs are initially unembryonated and are passed into the feces. These eggs then become embryonated into the soil in the next 10 to 14 days. And then they get ingested by the fish. These eggs reach the water bodies and are ingested by the fish. These eggs then release the larvae in the intestine of fish and the fish is then consumed by humans and the life cycle continues. Coming to the pathogenesis and clinical features, so mild to moderate worm load causes non-specific abdominal pain and watery diarrhea. Severe worm load can cause intestinal inflammation, loss of villi, crypt proliferation and eosinophilic granuloma. This leads to severe malabsorption and protein losing enteropathy and there is severe weight loss in the patient. Coming to the laboratory diagnosis, lab diagnosis is very simple. Stool examination is done to detect the egg. Stool is collected, a wet mount is prepared and we look for the presence of the characteristic eggs of the parasite. The infection can be treated with albendazole and severely ill patients require fluid replacement and supportive therapy. With this, we end with the discussion of intestinal nematodes 2. And before ending, let's go through a few expected questions. So there can be long answer questions like enlist the various intestinal nematodes and describe briefly the life cycle of either Trichinella or Triturus tritura or Enterobius vermicularis or Capillaria filipinensis. So here you have to enlist the intestinal nematodes and then explain the life cycle of whichever nematode is asked. Then short answer questions can be there like SAQ or Trichinella cyst or trichuriasis or egg of Triturus tritura, egg of Enterobius vermicularis, or egg of Capillaria filipinensis. So with this, we finish with our today's discussion. Thank you.